care is slowly being taken over by CDAC, by people like you, by biomedical engineers, application specialists, mobile network operators, policy decision makers, economists, and so on. Doctors like me, clinicians like me, are increasingly playing a smaller role, and this is what is going to happen in the future. In the third slide, I'm trying to convince you that in the future, there will be a hospital in your pocket, a laboratory in your pocket, a doctor in your pocket. I foresee that in the next 10 years, the number of brick and mortar hospitals, big hospitals like Apollo, All India Institute, PGI in Chandigarh, etc., will no longer be built. We will no longer have 1,000-bedded, 3,000-bedded hospitals. On the contrary, a hospital will be the last stop. Less than 5% of healthcare should be delivered in a hospital. Why is that? Because using technology, whatever was being done in hospitals 20 years ago is already started to be, we are starting to do it, not in hospitals, but in offices, in cinema theaters, in your house, and so on, which is what I'm going to show to you in the next 10 minutes. The next slide, now why did I get involved in telemedicine, and what is the necessity for telemedicine, not only in India, but in all the countries in Africa? Since many of you come, most of you come from Africa, I know I was a past president of the Neurological Society of India, and I am reasonably familiar with neurology, neurosurgery in Africa as well. A paper which I published 2 years ago, just 2 years ago, February 2015, conclusively demonstrated that in October 2014, 935 million Indians live in areas where there is not a single neurologist or a neurosurgeon. 80% of India's neurologists and neurosurgeons, as you can see from this slide, live in the state capitals, in the metros. A smaller percentage live in tier 2, tier 3 cities. The statistics, though the numbers will differ, will be very similar whether you take plastic surgery, cardiology, ophthalmology, or whatever it is. At the same time, India is a paradox. Last month, TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, announced that we have touched the 1 billion mark. That is, there are 1,000 million mobile phones in India, 30% of which are smart. In the next 10 years, 90% of India's villages are definitely going to have high-speed broadband fiber optic connectivity. So we wish to make use of this. This is the marriage between information communication technology and healthcare. Now, what exactly does telemedicine mean? Telemedicine makes geography, history, and distance meaningless. As you can see in this slide, basically it encompasses a term whereby all healthcare, whether it be preventive, diagnostic, for research purposes, for education, etc., can be delivered remotely with the doctor, the healthcare provider, not the doctor, with the healthcare provider and the patient, the consumer, the client, if you want to call it, being physically in different places. To practice good telemedicine, we not only require technology, we also require standards. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Okay. We require standards, we require medical records, we need to take into account professional negligence. Now, if you look at the Apollo Hospital group, on a single day, you will find we have about 1,500 admissions, we have treated 40 million patients, more than the population of several countries in Africa, 40 million patients from 1983 in 54 hospitals. It was on March 24th. You are able to see the next slide? Okay. It was on March 24, 2000 that Bill Clinton formally commissioned the world's first VSAT-enabled village hospital in Aragonda. Therefore, in 2015, the Indian Medical Association declared March 24th as National Telemedicine Day. Now, if I very quickly review what Apollo Telehealth Services has done in the last 17 years, as you can see in this slide, we have done almost 100,000 tertiary teleconsults, that is specialty and super specialty, in 25 specialties, almost 300,000 voice-based triage primary consults, and of course we have started the first public-private partnership telehealth service with the government of Himachal Pradesh. The next slide shows how we have organized several international conferences. Now we are organizing for the last 8 years a conference called Transforming Healthcare with IT. I will send Gaurav the details, and please, if any of you are interested, we would love to have you participate in this conference. If you come to my department, this is what you will find on a typical day. You will see about 70 to 80, sometimes 100 teleconsultations are done in tier 3 cities and the big towns. We have a few hospital on wheels, but unfortunately we are not using this regularly. On one particular occasion in February 2012, we did 527 teleconsults in just two days, which was then a world record. Now, what exactly do we do in the area of telemedicine? We have grown considerably now, and from one person who started the department in 2000, today we have almost 2000 employees, the majority in Hyderabad. So what do? We provide teleconsultations for our own patients, review cases. We have teleradiology services, including in Afghanistan, the Vallabhbhai Patel Chest Institute in Delhi. We have major public-private partnership where, in collaboration with the government of Himachal Pradesh, we are providing healthcare at 14,000 feet height in the Himalayas. A few months ago, we entered into a contract with the government of Andhra Pradesh in South India, where 164 primary health centers, these are called e-urban primary health centers, have been totally outsourced to Apollo Telehealth Services. It's a $40 million project, and for 3 years we will be providing primary health care to almost 15 million people population. In addition, we do CSR funding to some of the big mega multinational companies. We have just completed a screening of 300,000 people for diabetes, hypertension, and so on. As you can see in the next slide, several leading institutions of the world, Harvard Business School, Columbia University, Yale Institute of Management, and so on, have used what we have done as case studies. Some of their students have used this material for submitting dissertations, and I have personally mentored many students from these various universities. This includes the Wharton College. Wharton is one of the renowned business management institutions. A few minutes ago, I was telling you about the government of Andhra Pradesh. So here you can see part of our services include providing specialty teleconsults. We have a full-time orthopedic surgeon, endocrinologist, a general physician, a cardiologist, whose job is only to provide teleconsults to these 164 centers. I started off by saying that hospitals will become less and less in the future. Health will be moved out to the hospital and the doctor's office. Health will be moved to your house, to your office, to the grocery, and even to your car. Driverless cars today are slowly becoming a reality. Connected cars. In the US, for example, studies have shown that the average American citizen spends 3 to 4 hours a day in his car, and hence a car is being converted into a healthcare center so that several tests, etc., can be done and you can directly interact with the doctor. DIY, do it yourself. Why should a nurse take the blood pressure? Why, when today a patient uses a glucometer and checks his or her own blood sugar levels, she can also be helped to check her urea, creatinine, cholesterol, triglyceride, liver function test, renal function test, and so on. All this is possible. There is, of course, a downside in this. I belong to the BC era, before computers and before Christ were one and the same. I was the last neurosurgeon in India who was trained before even a CT scan came to India. Healthcare is something very personal. Unfortunately, today, with the advent of technology, this personal touch is being lost and health is becoming very, very impersonal. When the automobile, when the car was introduced in 1927, there was tremendous resistance. And as you can see from this slide, people did not want to give up the horse, which was what was being used for transport by the upper classes at that time. Letting go of old ideas is extremely difficult, or that was what we were taught. Today, it is just the opposite. Today's younger doctor let go of old ideas. Patients also, today we talk of the e-patient. Patient has more reliance on Dr. Facebook and Dr. Google than the regular medical doctor. You can see here, the e-patient is not just an electronic patient. He is equipped, he is enabled, he is empowered, he is an expert in his own, he thinks he is an expert, he is engaged. In fact, the E would even stand for etc. In the very beginning, I told you that we have a tremendous growth in information and communication technology. It's a 30% compound annual growth rate. Internet penetration is increasing tremendously. And this year, almost 15%, as you can see, or 45%, sorry, will be using mobile to access the internet. India is very quickly joining the advanced countries, and we are never ever going to be offline. We were taught that an apple a day keeps the doctor away. Today, there are almost 185,000 applications in healthcare alone which are available in Google Store. Whether all these applications are useful, whether they are necessary, whether they are reliable, whether they have been approved is a different story. But the message is that health applications are the single largest source of applications in the entire app industry. Information and communication technology is today recognized as one of the main pillars of the healthcare industry. And here again you can see from an economics point of view, if you want to make money, get into the field of healthcare applications. Cloud in healthcare. Cloud in healthcare is now being routinely used by most of the big hospitals, the corporate hospitals, the national institutes, etc. Software as a service, infrastructure as a service, everything comes to use and pay. It is cost effective, rapidly scalable, elastic, and most important, anytime, anywhere access. Cost effective also, in a couple of years, the initial large investment in by getting services in the cloud will totally be justified, and you will recover whatever money you have invested in. By 2020, which is just 3 years from now, you will find that the mobile health industry alone is going to exponentially increase, as you can see in the slide. In the years to come, the word telemedicine probably, it's already been replaced by telehealth, probably will be replaced by connected health. I think this is the correct word. It is not telehealth, but connected health. We are always connected, not just to healthcare providers, but more important, we are and will be connected to IoT, where M2M devices, where we have the Internet of Things, Internet of Everything, and these devices without human intervention will, through sensor technology, understand. I'm just giving an example, what is your blood sugar, and will directly give an instruction to the insulin stored in your body to release 5 units of insulin, and all this will be done even without your knowledge. The digital healthcare ecosystem is a huge industry. It starts even before you are born, and it continues even after you die. Today, sperms and ova can be frozen and kept if you know that somebody has got a terminal illness, a cancer, and the partner wishes to have a child impregnated with the spouse. This has already started happening in India. The day is not far off when EMR will be replaced with MPHR, that is a mobile personal health record. Again, from diagnosing and treating health conditions, even corporate hospitals like Apollo, a for-profit dividend declaring company, have realized that there is more money to be made by keeping the patients healthy. So creating wellness, e-wellness as you call it, promoting health literacy, this is the future, and this is going to be financially viable also. You are able to see the slides, I assume. Am I right? Hello?
Yes. Hello?
Okay, right. No, I want to be sure. I'm going on talking. I want to be sure that you are all not asleep and that you are seeing the slides and listening. Okay, fine. Now, M2M is a device where an event is captured, like an ECG, blood pressure, and this is relayed through a network. Instead of LAN and WAN, we now talk about BAN, a body area network, and it translates the captured event into meaningful information. This meaningful information is analyzed by an artificial intelligence system, which may or may not be reviewed by a physician, and corrective measures are introduced. So this is a network of what we call intelligent clothes. All this is available in the market already. These intelligent clothes have sensors, have transistors woven inside the bra or the banyan, and this is how information is going to be transmitted. Health applications will be the first choice for seeking information about healthcare. The smartphone will itself be a self-diagnostic tool, and you will be able to provide additional hardware in the smartphone which will serve the functions of a stethoscope, an ophthalmoscope, an otoscope, and even a 12-lead ECG, and even an ultrasound. In fact, it is foreseen that the first e-health lawsuit, somebody is going to file a case in the next couple of years because a computer killed a patient in the absence of a doctor. So will robots, will computers, will artificial intelligence be liable for a malpractice suit? These are the questions which are asked. Answers are yet to be forthcoming. The healthcare of the future is what is called 5P. We call it personalized medicine. We call it precision medicine. We call it preventive medicine. And so this is how medicine of the future is going to be. Personalized. Everything will be customized to suit your specific requirement. This rather complex slide, if you look into it in detail, summarizes almost everything of modern connected healthcare. This is the way healthcare will be transformed. This is the platform. We use a phone, chat, fax of course is hardly used nowadays, SMS, email. We must know about standards and regulations, interoperability, scalability, privacy, security, healthcare analytics, healthcare education, treatment guidelines. Care itself can be preventive, curative, emergency, and so on. And who are the participants in this connected health? Participants are the patient, the provider. Please note the word provider. I am not saying doctor, because already we have a new group of people called the physician assistant, nursing assistant, healthcare provider. So these people will eventually take over from the medical doctor of today so far as primary healthcare is concerned. Pharmacy, insurance company, the government, payers, all this are going to be very important. All this will come under a category called HIN or Health Information Networks. These health information networks will have a very complex interrelation, which this slide tries to emphasize. And here you can see you have an enterprise portal, a regional health network, the primary physician, pharmaceuticals, insurance companies, and so on. Continuing medical education is vital. Doctors need to stay current of at least 10,000 diseases, minimum 3,000 drugs which are used in daily practice, 1,100 laboratory tests, 400,000 articles are added to the literature each year. Obviously, it's impossible even for a super sub-specialist to learn even 1% of what is happening in his specialty. Therefore, the only way to do that is to condense the data, extract the data, take out whatever is important. The beautiful photograph which you see in the bottom of the slide is not a photograph of a cadaver, but it is digital manipulation. These photographs have been built by engineers, by computer specialists, simulating the God-given thorax and the abdomen. So virtual reality as a training tool is going to be used. If you come to the COO, the Chief Operating Officer of any large hospital complex, this is what you will find in his room. You will find a dashboard, and depending on the complexity and how big the group is, for example, 54 hospitals in the Apollo group, about 25 of them are already connected. So the COO or the authorized individual can in real time understand exactly how many people died, how many admissions were there, what were the complications, how much money was generated, how many people were absent today, etc., etc. We are already doing this for the Andhra Pradesh government, the UPHC. The Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh can, on his smartphone, should he so desire, look at minute to minute in real time in a dashboard. He knows that today in this PHC, 2 people came, in the other PHC, 22 people came, and yesterday 3,832 people came, and so many, etc., etc. So this is what is available today already. Now this is how, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So this is how the screen will look like. The modern hospital administrator screen will be almost what the NASA Space Center in Houston was several years ago. So a complex But at the same time, simple, you can see every bit of data will be available. Connect all hospitals to one centralized system, monitor key business parameters online, anytime, anywhere access for decision makers. Now, even though the initial investment is high, the operational efficiency increases by up to 30%. Having information at your fingertips makes all the difference, and you are able to significantly improve the quality of the healthcare delivered. India is now talking of smart cities. We are talking of smart villages. It is going very fast. Companies called SPV or special purpose vehicle have already been formed. There are at least 20 companies have been formed. Smart city for Dharamshala, smart city for Chennai, for Coimbatore and so on. So all this is going to become a reality in the next couple of years. The smart city concept will also include smart healthcare, and the Apollo Telehealth Services has prepared a white paper and we have submitted a detailed report to the government for consideration. Smart living, smart environment, all this of course presupposes smart people. Green buildings, green energy. These slides are not cut and paste. These slides are not just giving a theoretical lecture, but these are all being studied in great detail, and I am absolutely certain that in the next 4 to 5 years, we will have at least 10 such smart cities in India with smart healthcare, where there will be kiosks on different parts of the road, Wi-Fi enabled. We already have districts in India which are totally Wi-Fi enabled. So the world is going to change rapidly. In the future of technology, doctors will be prescribing medical applications rather than drugs. A doctor's job will be to provide URL, will be to tell the patient that this website is better than that website, go here, go there, and so on. Merging of health records and social networks will create a sharing medical society. Already, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all these things are being increasingly used for healthcare. From 2010 to 2020, the term disruptive business model is what is going to be used, because for doctors and administrators who were primarily working in 2010, they will find this truly disruptive. You will have automated kiosks. You will have medical homes, smart homes. You will have retail clinics, home monitoring, wireless health devices, mobile care services, real estate. Today, in all, even tier 2, tier 3 cities and the metros, we have mega complexes of 1,000 flats, 1,500 flats. These huge apartment complexes will have not a mini hospital, but almost a regular hospital staffed by just 2 or 3 people, but connected online with specialists in big hospitals. In this slide, you can see a Wi-Fi enabled environment. Let's take Delhi for example. Unfortunately, Delhi has been ranked as the world's most polluted city. And here, your smartphone can have a few sensors which you need to buy, assuming you are an asthmatic. These sensors will pick up the dust in the air, 12 parts per million. Permissible is 3 to 5 ppm. Let us say that on a particular day, the pollution is extremely high. You will get a message on the rear view of your car or inside your car telling you that you are now going to this particular place. The intelligent connected car knows this because you have already set your GPS. The car knows you are an asthmatic, and therefore the car will tell you it is more than permissible. Don't take this route, take another route even if it is longer. All this is now just started happening in Europe. It's a question of time before we get it in India. A major problem in healthcare, whether it is diabetes, hypertension, epilepsy, or any chronic disease, is the lack of compliance and adherence. In other words, patients, including myself, I am a medical doctor, I'm supposed to know about importance in healthcare, but because I'm generally healthy, I have no specific problem, it is very difficult for me to take medicines which I need to take, and several days, quite often, I forget to take a tablet which I should have taken. So, this is universal all over the world. It's not being done deliberately. So, modern containers for capsules will have, they're all extremely inexpensive, they will have sensors. These sensors will send you a message to your smartphone, to your laptop, whatever it is, reminding you that you have not taken the drug this morning. And when the tablets become less, a message will automatically go to your pharmacy, telling your pharmacy to refill the bottle which is going to be empty. The most important thing which I would like all of you to understand is that do not make the mistake which I made. 15 years ago, 10 years ago, even 3 years ago, we never ever realized that the future was not something hypothetical, but it will come very soon. The video conferencing camera, which we bought even 5 years ago, even 3 years ago, today has become obsolete. There are no spare parts, no replacement. Mobile phone, which I bought 3 years ago, the value has come down to 10%. So whatever you invest in, please remember to tell the vendor that you must have upgrades, even if it is a little more expensive, it is worthwhile entering into a contract to get upgrades, both software and hardware. These are smart clothes. For lack of time, I am not spending too much time on all this. This is just to show you the rapid advances of medicine. Now, generally speaking, the public thinks that Apollo Hospital is a quaternary care hospital which does heart transplants, liver transplants and complicated procedure. On August 25th, 2015, Apollo Hospitals formally accepted an offer from the government to try to provide primary health care to 60,000 internet-enabled villages in India. We have just started on this. It's an extremely difficult project. We have now virtually connected to about 12,000 and physically connected to about 120. The numbers are still small, but it is our hope that eventually we will reach at least a figure of 1,000 consults a day. Even last year or 2 years ago, nobody, even I would not have believed that Apollo Hospitals will be organizing this sort of contact program. We are now getting into the real villages. We are promoting health literacy using technology and we are trying to inculcate a health-seeking behavior into the population. Now, mobile health, as I already told you, shoes and socks will have sensors. Your refrigerator will be intelligent. You have intelligent toilets, and today a single breath test can detect 17 diseases, including some types of cancer. This is pure medicine, just to tell you what is happening. Now here again, this is a conference which I attended 2 years ago, and it was amazing to wear this very sophisticated computer where video streaming could be seen 3D, augmented reality, virtual reality and so on. By just wearing this, I could see an ultrasound video directly on both of the glasses which you can see. You can see here, this is the tonsils. This is exactly what I would have seen. In fact, it's better than what I would have seen had I asked the patient to open his mouth and say, a very simple software program and a camera attached to an ordinary phone. This is the sort of detail which you can get. As you can see here, I'm running the mouse. This is a Pentium i5 processor, i7 processor. And this camera, this spectacles, has all the functionality of a 2016 laptop computer. So live streaming can be done. So again, I foresee that in the next 1 or 2 years, a formal telemedicine department like what we started with today. 15 years ago or 10 years ago, doctors used to come to my department. Now we have 5 sub-centers within the hospital, in the basement, ground floor, first floor, fourth floor, and so on. Very soon, all teleconsultations will be done from the doctor's individual cabin, from his desktop, laptop, smartphone, etc. So a brick and mortar telemedicine department also will eventually be a non-entity. Here you see a sensor. This is a comprehensive sensor. All you have to do is just wear this, a stick on your collarbone, and when you pass through, like let's say airport security, you pass through, at least 30 different health parameters will be recorded and sent to the doctor. Toilets have already become intelligent. This is commercially viable today, commercially available today, particularly in Japan. So every time you empty your bladder or every time you pass motion, if you are using a particular toilet, the through GPS, they will know exactly who is using it, and an analysis will be done. For example, occult blood. A drop of blood may be found in the urine or the motion, which you would never ever have normally found out, and this message will be transmitted immediately to your doctor. This is Dr. Mirror. Today you have sophisticated cameras which are enclosed inside the mirror, so when you are having a shave or washing your face, etc., etc., lots of things can be done. For lack of time, I'm not going into the details. And here again, the smartphone, and on the lower left hand side you find a fork and a knife, and this fork is Bluetooth enabled. This has got sensors, so every time you cut your chicken or whatever it is that you are eating, it will analyze if there is arsenic inside the food, or if there is molybdenum or something, and this information will be transferred. There are also cameras within the knife, within the fork. These cameras will take photographs and will inform you that you should not take that brownie which you are about to put into your mouth, because your last cholesterol and triglyceride was extremely high. These have still not become commercially available, but it's just a question of time. Today we have intelligent carts like this. When you go to sleep, the cart will test about 10 or 15 parameters, keep relaying them automatically. So by the time you wake up, your doctor would already have known if you have any problems. This was introduced actually by one of my colleagues long ago, 8-9 years ago, in a small city in Tamil Nadu. Today it's freely available. You can swallow this capsule. There are patients who don't have time to go to the hospital for an endoscopy, so you just swallow this capsule. It contains sophisticated cameras, and this takes photographs every 2 seconds, and once you pass the camera through the rectum, the camera is collected and then the photographs are analyzed. Wearable technology. Today bras are available which will check the temperature, and this could be an early method of detecting lumps in the breast. This particular slide, called POCD or point of care diagnostics, we have been using this extensively both in the Himalayas and in one of our CSR projects. 22 tests today can be done: liver function tests, renal function tests, cardiac enzymes, and so on, using specific, as you can see on the right hand side, multicolored something like a memory stick. You just put this in and you will be able to check for hemoglobin and so on. The mobile phone, both through hardware and software, many functions which can be done in a laboratory can be done. On the top right hand side, I don't know if you are able to make out, my mouse is scrolling here, you see a red line and a green line. All you need to do, are you able to see it?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, so this red line and the green line, all you need to do is play about with the numbers on your mobile phone until the green line and the red line are superimposed on each other. The built-in software program knows exactly which button you pressed, which number you pressed, the series of numbers which you pressed. And based on this, it calculates your refractive error. It is very sad that in India, and I understand in Africa also, a large number of people, I'm talking of millions of people, are legally blind, not because they have diabetic retinopathy, not because they have glaucoma, not because they have ocular tumors, but simply because there is nobody to examine their vision and prescribe glasses. So, refractive error is the commonest treatable cause of preventable blindness. And this simple software program, if made universally applicable, can do it. You are supposed to hear a cough now. I don't know whether, because it's not a PPT, unfortunately, it's a PDF. So had you looked at the PPT, you would have heard a cough and cough into a phone and get a diagnosis. The bottom line, of course, is with increasing technology, there will be more problems also. You can see pacemakers can be hacked. The US government issued a cyber security warning. The most famous story is of Al Gore, the former vice president of the United States of America, who was having a cardiac pacemaker. Somebody tried to kill him by hacking the software program in the pacemaker by resetting the heart rate from 70 per minute to 10 per minute. Luckily, this was identified and prevented. So please remember, hacking to kill somebody is quite likely to happen in the future. I am extremely happy that whatever I am talking about is not just theory. As early as 2016, the government of India, the Ministry of Information Technology formed a committee of which I was also a member. It's called the M2M Health Working Group, and a very exhaustive report has been presented, and this is available on the website. Technical standards for medical and healthcare interactions, Internet of Things, is already available. Just a few more minutes I'll spend. This is Himachal Pradesh, where we are doing a major program, 14,000 feet height, minus 25 degrees temperature, 5 months in a year, the district is totally cut off. So our staff go house to house and do a screening with the point of care diagnostics, hemoglobin, blood sugar, so many tests can be done. Now here is an example of a clinical, actual clinical practice. We have a tele-emergency services. This is an old slide. I didn't have time to change it. Today we have done about 620 emergency cases. Here is an example of a patient who had a pulse rate of 240 per minute. Is there any doctors there? This is called supraventricular tachycardia. And this is a video. Again, this being a... I wish we had shown the original video. This was a video. In this video, you would have seen there is a mannequin here. The treatment was defibrillation. Unfortunately, the nurse who was trained in defibrillation by us was not available on that particular day. We knew the patient may die. So the emergency doctor was very smart. He said, "Don't worry, I will guide you." And he took a mannequin. You can see here, we have a very big emergency department. And he demonstrated how to do a defibrillation, and for the very first time in her life, a young nurse in the Himalayas saw this and followed the instructions given by the doctor in Chennai, did it correctly, and following the defibrillation, the patient was totally all right. We have treated 7 patients, I understand, like this, including cases of myocardial infarction. Promoting health literacy is important. This is another project we are doing, where about 86 sessions have been conducted twice a month, about 7 to 11 villages, and these 7 to 11 villages, more than 20,000 people have gone to these, come to these, will attend these talks, and we try to promote health literacy. So this is the India of today, and you can see right from whether you are a few months old to whether you are 90 years old, people have slowly becoming familiar with digital India, with computers, smartphones, etc. You need to be ready for the future, and I, for one, am absolutely certain that in my lifetime, within the next 10 years, I will definitely, we will see people going to outer space as tourists, and the Indian Space Research Organization is undoubtedly the world's leader. We launched 104 satellites in 3 hours in rapid succession just a few weeks ago. So finally, I never talk of achieving world class. In 2017, the world should talk of achieving India class. I no longer talk of following high standards. We talk of setting high standards for others to follow. We have the world's leaders in technology, software. Americans are so frightened of Indians that they are making it more and more difficult for Indians to live in the US, and we will see what happens when all, if the Indian software engineers living in the US are asked to go out, US will certainly collapse. At the same time, we have the Mecca of medical care in India. Almost 100,000 people come every year to India for tertiary and quaternary care, including Canadians, white Americans. Africa, of course, is the single largest continent from where we get. I think we get almost 70,000 people every year from Africa for complex treatment. But so we have the best of IT in the world, we have the best of medical care in the world, but we still have not integrated information technology with healthcare. Don't think the future starts tomorrow. The future starts yesterday, not even today. The future is always ahead of schedule. You may ignore reality, but you cannot ignore the consequences of ignoring reality. Sorry. I'll stop with this. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to take them. I hope you're able to hear me and see all the slides, right?
Yes, sir. So we are very thankful to you. It is such a nice experience for all of us, for sharing your experience and through presentation and your talk. So any questions? It will be sir, somebody has a question. Yes, you can ask your question over here.
No. Take a photo.
Yes, please pass on the mic. Mic is here.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, you hear me?
Yeah, well, loud and clear. Please go ahead.
Okay. My name is Mossad. I'm from Egypt. I want to thank you about sharing your experience with us today. And actually, I was expecting, it was an interesting presentation and demo, but I was expecting some practical implementation to telemedicine in India. Maybe I in patient side and you in the other side, and in patient side use some IoT sensors or something like that, and send you some tests, and you diagnose this test and respond with diagnosis and your recommendation. I'm expecting that, but I didn't see that in presentation.
Okay, good, very good. I'll tell you now, I'll answer your question, the limitations of telemedicine. Now, one of the major limitations of telemedicine is India is a huge, huge country. We still have not been able to crack a business model, whether it is a government or a private sector or a trust. Unless there is revenue, unless it is a profitable venture, unless we generate revenue, no telemedicine will be self-sustaining. For every 100 telemedicine departments which are opened, 90 of them close down within 6 months to 1 year. There are very few telemedicine departments which continue, and even these are not rapidly expanding. Apollo Hospital started rapidly expanding only about 2 years ago when the government agreed to use telemedicine for public-private partnership. So the most, if you ask me, the most difficult part, I'll now tell you why telemedicine programs do not succeed. That is more important than knowing why they succeed. First is vitamin M. Second is vitamin M. Third is vitamin M. You know what is vitamin M?
No.
No? Come on, guess.
Money.
Ah, okay. That's right.
I got it.
So money. Now, unless the doctor is compensated, unless the doctor is paid to give a teleconsultation, he will not be enthusiastic about it. Or alternatively, his employer must make it mandatory or compulsory for him to provide teleconsultations as part of his job. That is number one. Number two, the second part is, though I talk about 90% connectivity and all that, India, as I said, is a paradox. We have villages with superb connectivity, but we still are in the transition stage. Lot of problems still. Yeah, CDAC, a big organization like CDAC and Apollo, 4 days ago we were unable to do this conference for various reasons. I'm told ISDN lines, I'm told incompatibility, interoperability, all these big fancy words. So for the last 15 years we have been doing this, we still had a problem. So we still have problems, technical problems with all this. Number three, awareness. Though we have tried our best to create awareness, and definitely people now have some idea of what is telemedicine, a huge country like India or Africa, a lot more requires to be done. Majority of the government, of individual doctors, of patients are still not aware of telemedicine. The fourth thing is success stories. Unfortunately, the few of us who are very passionate about it and started this long ago, we neither have the time nor the funding nor the the interest, if you want to call it, to go out and talk to the press. And see, unless the media goes on reporting successful case stories, etc., people will not understand what is telemedicine. So these are some of our major problems.
My name is Michael from Uganda. Thank you so much, Professor Matas, for that informative presentation. Yeah, telemedicine may not replace the work of the doctors, but maybe to as an enabling tool for equitable and quality delivery of healthcare. Need to know how India has helped our medical doctors to look at technology as an enabler in a way of like integrating it in the curriculum for medical training, such that they don't look at it as something like an extra workload during their time of like work. They don't look at it as an extra workload, but look at it as something to facilitate the delivery of healthcare. So how has India helped the doctors, or how have they integrated it into the curriculum of medical training?
Well, very good question. In 2003, I started a course with an engineering university. I ran 6 batches, 120, not doctors, doctors, engineers, people like you, whoever wanted to join the course. Unfortunately, the real practical problems are, I was able to give employment only to 4 out of the 150. So I had to stop the course. This was in 2003. We are now trying to revive the course. There are enormous problems in adding course content to a medical curriculum. Already the MBBS course, you know, at the MBBS level, everybody wants, the cardiologist wants 100 hours, the neurologist wants 100 hours, immunologist, etc., etc., etc. So that is a major, major problem. We are trying our best. The papers are still pending with the Medical Council of India. We are hoping that at least in the next year or two, permission will be given. You are absolutely right. But simultaneously, I am now ready, and I would love to share this with Africa. We can either do this to the, I've told the Pan-African Network people also, CDAC can help, all of you can help. I have 180 hours of course curriculum, including e-book, including course material, and I have access to an outstanding faculty, not only in India, but outside India. So 80% or 90% of the course content can be delivered online. And the remaining 10%, we can have a 2-day, 3-day hands-on workshop. Now this can be done at CDAC Mohali, can be done at Apollo Delhi, Apollo Chennai, etc., etc. in India. Alternatively, if there are enough people, we can even 2 or 3 of the instructors can come to 1 or 2 or even 3 cities in Africa. And this can definitely be done. I am ready. In 2 months, I am confident I can start the course. But then I cannot do it unilaterally. We require your assistance. If some university or any appropriate body in a single country or in multiple countries, I'm sure you have many, now for example, the Nigeria e-health Association of Nigeria. I was in Tunisia a few weeks ago, the Algerian Society of Telemedicine, etc., etc. So if some, but then it requires a lot of effort and time. If somebody can get together and help us at the African end, we are ready with course content and the full design of the program.
Okay. I think you can have the last question.
Yeah. Good morning. I'm Saed. I'm a medical doctor. I come from Palestine. I'd like to thank you first for the presentation you have presented. It was really interesting, and we got a lot of information, and we've seen some issues you've been presenting. I'd like to ask a question about the quality of service which will be provided to the patients who are treated by the telemedicine. Like you've said at the beginning of the lecture, that less than 5% of patients should be admitted to the hospital. The other 95% should be treated in the primary healthcare centers, or they should be treated in a telemedicine way. Also, what we have seen at the last 10 slides, the last 10 slides in the presentation, that people can make an ECG for themselves by the smartphone. A nurse who never hold a DC shock, she can provide the patient with a supraventricular tachycardia with a DC shock. Also about the laboratory tests that the patients can do it for himself, like blood sugar, urine, creatinine, etc. So my question is, what quality these patients will receive? Is the quality will be quite efficient, as if they are attending the hospital, attending our clinics? That's my question. And in case there will be misdiagnosing and will be medical legal case, who will be responsible for that? And thank you.
Very good questions. I'll answer your second question first. Day before yesterday, on Saturday, we had a full 1-day, 8-hour workshop on the legal aspects, regulatory aspects, income tax, taxation aspects, etc., etc. And the answer to your last question is very simple. I do not know. Nobody knows. The government of India has yet to form an act or a bill. There are no rules or regulations spelling out what should be done, what should not be done, what cannot be done, can be done, etc., etc. All this is still in the draft stage. We are again hoping in the next 2-3 years all these things will be sorted out. Having said that, I expect my consultants, and they are told very, very clearly that they are mature enough not to give an opinion when the quality of the audio or the video or whatever information is given to them is not 100% good. Now, I personally have given about 1,500 consults in neurosurgery, neurology in the last 16, 17 years. Earlier on, when the technology was not good, at least on 10% of cases, I have said the quality of the picture is not good. Sorry, I cannot give an opinion. You have to come personally. That is one safeguard. I will err on the side of caution and I would rather not give a diagnosis and confess that I cannot give a diagnosis rather than give a wrong diagnosis. The answer to your first question is, again, this is a chicken and egg story. The classical chicken and egg story. Which comes first? I am frustrated. I continue to be frustrated because I give a teleconsultation as a neurosurgeon with 39, 40 years of experience. I make what I think is a great diagnosis of, let's say, temporal lobe seizures, and I prescribe a tablet called carbamazepine. Now, what is the use? Carbamazepine is not available in that particular town. Or alternatively, I want an MRI, I want a CT scan, that's not available there. So the patient has to go somewhere else. He has to come back to me. Who is going to pay for the CT? Who is going to pay for the MRI? So these are all complex problems which cannot be solved. Teleconsultation at the moment is only a sophisticated form of teletriage. My role, I think, is to reduce the number of people coming to a big hospital in a big city. I can confidently, through telemedicine, tell that this headache, you don't have to go and see a neurosurgeon in Delhi or Madras because you fought with your mother-in-law yesterday and you have problems with your wife. That is the cause of your headache, not a brain tumor or hemorrhage in the brain. So in other words, we exclude, but the 20% of headaches where I do want further investigations, I am helpless. I have to tell them you must have a CT or an MRI done. Unfortunately, again, they are lost to follow up. I have no mechanism in place. I am not an academic university. I don't have postgraduate students. I don't have research assistants. I don't have anybody to ensure that a follow up is done. So all this requires funding. Ultimately, it's all a question of vitamin M. The more money I have for my project, the better will be the quality of service done.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Sir, thank you so much for this informative session. I'm sure the audience will be delighted about the use of telemedicine and more specifically vitamin M, as you talked about in the end. So I believe that's a critical factor in the success of such projects, and they should give due consideration for these things when they implement these projects back in their own country. Right. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your time. We really appreciate you giving your time once again on this day after the scheduling, and we look forward to more sessions in the coming future.
Thank you. Any of you have any specific questions, please feel free to send me a mail. I'll respond to you.
Correct.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.